Good morning, Elm Street. Welcome to our online services. Thank you for allowing us in your house today. I'm just going to start us off with a word of prayer, but I'm going to read through Psalm 91, verses 14 through 16, and then I'll pray after that. Just kind of have this be our prayer to start out with. So starting at verse 14, "Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation." Dear God, we come to you today just humbly, thankfully that we can be in your presence. I pray that we really dive into what's being shared in the message today, and we can apply that to our lives the best way that we can throughout this time. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen. So now we're going to continue our worship. We're going to throw it over to Guy, and they're going to play us a few songs.
You are holy. You are mighty. You are worthy. Worthy of praise. I will follow, I will live the same, I will love you all of my days.
I'm Welcome back, Elm Street. This is our fourth online week. So not only that, according to our government officials, it looks like we're going to be separated, right, all through April. So this is going to be a long time coming. Get used to it, I guess. This may be the new normal. I don't know. But one thing that we're pretty excited about is this is Palm Sunday. Next week is Easter Sunday. And with Easter, we wanted, because we missed everybody, we want you guys to send a video, short video, 3, maybe 5 seconds. Send it into church of your family, just saying, Happy Easter, Elm Street Christian Church from the Burkharts. You're not all Burkharts, so whatever family you are, send that in. In fact, I would do that right now, even if you got a little space, or right after the service. But info@escnet.com. Email to that email address, and then we'll compile all those, and that'll be our initial start for Easter next weekend. Okay? Make sense? Don't forget about it. We want lots of videos from your family. So here we go. I started thinking this week, especially with this whole COVID-19, that we're starting to experience and feel a little bit what maybe missionaries feel like. Think about it. We send them off to some isolated country to be alone. And when they're alone, I mean, they go sometimes with no Christians around, and their only engagement with other Christians is something like this, right? Just video, technology, something, but they're on their own. And so some of you guys may be feeling that. And I started thinking even further, we will remember this coronavirus for the rest of our lives. Right? Some of us are old enough to remember back to 9/11 and that whole day. We remember that whole day and what happened. I think we're going to remember this as the same way. But I want us to control how we remember it. Right? I don't want us to just think of the negative things that happened, right? The separation, the isolation, the social distancing, the fact that you ran out of toilet paper or hand sanitizer. I would love for us, I think God would love for us to capitalize on this moment. And so here's the thing. Will you remember the COVID-19, or will you remember that God used you in a brand new way that you never even thought of? Right? Will you remember being locked up, inconvenienced? Or will you remember how God opened doors for you to minister to others? Will you remember the lack of toilet paper? Or will you remember the fact that you changed your faith on a real, practical, daily level? And what's neat, just watching you guys, right, through social media, is seeing how creative you're getting at serving other people, right? You're looking for it. So instead of just going to church and exercising your faith, like, I'm going to go to church to practice my faith, many of you have started thinking, I'm going to be the church to exercise my faith. You're doing church out in our community. You're doing church by helping other people. I'm telling you, Elm Street, it's amazing to watch. It's fun. And to list all those out would take forever. So I just want you to know again, we're proud of you. It is neat, joyful, prideful to just be able to boast in Jesus and what he's doing through you. So good job. So again, it's going to be another month before we get together. And I want us to remember this phrase. I came across this just a few days ago. Here it is. Our church's mission, Elm Street Christian Church, our mission is not to host a worship service. Our mission is not to put on a program. Our mission, don't forget, is that we want to know Christ and to make him known. We don't mistake method for mission. The method of doing what we do could be a church service. This is another method right here, right? This technology going from my mouth out into the interweb, into your television or screen or phone, right? It's just another method of helping you encounter Jesus, right? Disciple believers and to mobilize the saints. That's our purpose. That's what we're doing. So let's change gears. Along with that gear, if you will, too, is this whole triumphal entry of Jesus. Palm Sunday, starting this whole week, we call the Passion Week of Jesus. And you think about all that went on during that week. So Sunday, the crowds come together, they cheer on Jesus, Hosanna, here he comes riding in on a donkey, right? Entering Jerusalem. And Monday, he goes into the temple and he angers everybody, tossing out the vendors, tossing the tables, angers the leaders there. Tuesday, he confronts the hypocrisy of the Jewish leaders. Wednesday, Judas is bribed to betray Jesus. Thursday is the Last Supper. And that's when Judas then betrays Jesus and Peter denies Jesus. And then Friday, we get to Jesus' crucifixion. And the chief priests rally the people to chant, crucify him, crucify him. And I think about that whole time, Jesus had a purpose. He knew exactly what he was doing. He wasn't stuck. And part of the thing I started thinking about is being stuck is even here, we're isolated, right? I hate being isolated. Like I talked about last week, I hate being contained. Have you ever driven a long distance and just got super antsy? Like you got to get out of the car, right? Just to get out and just start running around in circles, even frolicking. I just want to frolic through a field sometimes. Have you ever got that way? I'm starting to feel that. Like, I got to get out. I can't be contained anymore. And so being on vacation, even, you go out and you got this long drive home. Nothing feels better than coming home, right? It feels good. It's almost like you get to take a vacation from the vacation. You're able to be back at home and be in your regular rhythm. You're where you belong. And so I want you to kind of picture that. This is what Jesus is trying to get at in this whole last week. This whole last week, if you read through John, chapters 15, actually 13 on through the end, I believe he's trying to get his disciples to exactly where they need to belong. And where they need to belong is together. Right? So where you belong. The overwhelming emphasis in John is not on individuals, not you, not me, but on the organic connection that Jesus creates among those who put their trust in him, right? He's trying to develop this idea of family, togetherness. We are better together. We belong together. And so you can see this all throughout John, starting in chapter 13, but in John 15, Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. There is no other way to be a disciple of Jesus than to be in communion with other believers. Being in communion with other disciples. If I want to be close to Jesus, I need to be close to his family. And that's why this whole time, it makes it tricky because we're so used to just coming in this big room and thinking that's being together. And that's part of being a family, but it's the interaction. It's the beautiful things that you guys are doing for one another, encouraging, edifying one another, that makes us a family. If I want to be close to Jesus, I need to be close with His family. And following Jesus, being in this family, means I'm trying to become who Jesus would be if He were me. And we know Jesus loved the church, died for her, called her His bride. He spent His life for the church. It's kind of like hot coals, right? And I wonder, again, if we're in this boat of being separated. Jesus designed for us to be together. Do you feel like a hot coal that's been removed from the fire? Right? And if you do that out on a campfire, you pull that out, it dies out seemingly quick. The rest of them stay pretty hot for a while. They can last all night if they're together. But you drag that coal away and it starts to die out. And maybe you, if you're joining for the first time, you don't know anything about Elm Street, you may be feeling like that dried out coal. There's no heat there. No more passion for what God's called you to do. You need the family. We're better together. So the night before Jesus died, He washed His disciples' feet. Right? And how beautiful that would have been. You know, He told them during that time, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another." The disciples of Jesus were called to love deeply one another. "Even as I have loved you." And He says, by this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. And how do we love one another? We give, we serve, we encourage, we prod along, we lead one another spiritually, right? We're looking out for each other constantly. It's John 17, verse 11, in His big prayer for you and I, the whole church, His prayer is that we would be one. And so I want to remind you, our church's mission is not to host a service. It's not to host a program. Don't mistake our method for our mission. Our mission is we want to know Christ deeply, intimately, and we want others to know Him. And we're going to do this by helping people encounter Jesus. We're going to help them by discipling believers. And we're going to help them by mobilizing the saints, going out for the non-members, being a light to Richland County. And then we get to the last part of John, the crucifixion. And we see, I almost picture it as everybody is starting to dissipate, right? They're starting to take off. They were all there, gathered together. You know, picture the normal three crosses, the thief on the left and the right. The soldiers have done all their thing. They've done their bickering. The Pharisees are saying, "Hey, you could have got down on the cross if you wanted to. Prove yourself." And here we get to some of His last words, and I think the last words of Jesus have to be huge, right? They have to be like the big statement. And so Mary, you see at the foot of the cross, along with John, who writes the book of John. And Mary stands out throughout Scripture to be a very faithful disciple, following Him all the way to the cross. And at the cross, Jesus gives two unrelated believers to one another. You have Mary and John standing there, and here's what they say. Here's what Jesus says in John chapter 19, verses 25 and following. "Near the cross of Jesus stood His mother, His mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw His mother there, and the disciple whom He loved standing nearby, He said to His mother, 'Dear woman, this here is your son.' And to the disciple He said, 'Here is your mother.' And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home." Mary becomes a member of a new family brought together in Christ's death. John and Mary brought together and told by Jesus, "You are family. You are together. And in Christ's death, human beings are brought into reconciliation with Christ and with each other. And here, during this suffering, Jesus speaks of what really matters. His last words, his relationship with God and our relationship with each other. He hated the thought of being separated from God and truly desired for you and I to be together, united. And you know, I mean, again, I picture all kinds of people listening in, people from Elm Street, people not from Elm Street. There could be people on the other side of the globe listening in, right? Some that are lost, some that don't know Jesus, don't know the church. But I know we could all look at the church and just pick her apart and think about all the negative, wrong things that she's done, that maybe she's doing now, right? It's almost become very easy to dismiss the church. You know, it could break your heart. And trust me, it's broke my heart a couple times. Every day, it seems like there's another error that you could pick out. And it could be easy to say, I could be Christian without the church. But Jesus is against that idea. Jesus, John, Paul, and God all stand for you as the church to be united, to be working with one another as we see you doing now. At the cross, Jesus gave you to me and me to you. So this whole time of separation, right? We've been a month apart and we're going to be a month apart again, at least. It's opened my eyes wider to what God has meant for us. Just meeting here, which is essential to your faith. It's an incredible habit. And here at Elm Street, we call it one of those keystone habits that we practice. But we weren't meant to be alone. We truly are better together. The church offers hope. The church offers inspiration and motivation. The church offers encouragement, a desire to bring God's kingdom to our community, our county, a need to be more godly because people need us to be more godly. The church offers companionship, a constant drumbeat and reminder to keep the main thing the main thing. Church, I want to tell you, you are great. Because Jesus said, you are great. Church, you are needed. Maybe more now than ever. Church, our mission is not to host a program or a service. Don't mistake method for mission. We exist to know Christ and to make him known. And we do that by helping people encounter Jesus, to come to the foot of the cross and understand the forgiveness and hope that's there. We do this by discipling other believers. We are intentionally trying to make each other better and mobilizing the saints. It's almost like we've been forced to be mobilized, right? You're sent, whether you like it or not, you're out there. We've been forced to be a light, to love on other people. And I want to tell you, we're not just going to get through this. We're going to grow through this. I believe Elm Street is going to be way better because of all this, because we got to focus on that mission. Christians have gathered for 2,000 years because they all love our Lord, the Savior. We have many sins to forgive, but we are still the body of Christ. I'm going to pray for you, and then we'll have Mitchell do communion. God, I thank you for this opportunity. And for some of us, it's incredibly hard, whether it's just the isolation, whether it's the loss of job or whatever the case, God, we thank you for this opportunity to draw closer to you, to know more about our purpose, our mission. So God, help us to live it out, to truly be a light, to be an anchor for other people. So God, watch over us and keep us. And we pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So as we close out, I'm going to turn it over to Mitchell to lead us in a time of communion and offering.
So for our communion time today, during the sermon, it reminded me of my favorite passage of scripture, and that's in Amos 5, verse 21 through 24. So I'll read that. I hate, I despise your feasts, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. In the peace offerings of your fattened animals, I will not look upon them. Take away from me the noise of your songs to the melody of your harps. I will not listen. But let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. If we're talking about being Christian instead of doing all this Christian stuff, that verse almost couldn't be any better for that topic. So whenever we're taking our communion, I want you to refocus your mind, try to really be with Christ. Picture him up on the cross like you were there, right? Because I think a lot of times we think Christianity is all this doing stuff. But really, Christ didn't die on the cross for you to go do something. He died on the cross for you to be with him. So just ponder that during this time. I'm going to pray for us, and then we'll keep going with communion. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for all that you do. Thank you for being our God, being our Lord, and saving us. God, we pray right now that we can remember what it's like to just be with you, to just sit there and to just be your children, to realize that you're our dad, that you are the one who holds us, and to just be in the moment with you. So we love you, and we thank you for all that you've done. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So how this is going to work, we're literally going to give you 2 minutes for you to get your communion stuff ready and for you to take it and for you to reflect and all that kind of stuff. So you got 2 minutes. So we're going to go into a time of offering. First of all, this has been really weird for all of us, right? I am personally impressed with Elm Street because a lot of you are still continuing to give. You still believe in the mission of Elm Street. You still believe in the work that Christ is doing in Richland County, even though it's the weirdest time that I've been alive anyway. So first of all, thank you for that. I also want to remind you how you can give. You can just go to our elmstreetchristianchurch.org website. And then there's a little button on the top right of your screen, should be, for giving. It might say donations, I'm not sure, but it's one of those two. Click that and then just go through the prompt that it has for you there. Don't let yourself get discouraged by having to be home all the time, but really dive into maybe what Jesus is trying to tell you this week, how you can be closer with him, how you can still be his children. So you are sent. Be blessed.